Check it out now, y'all.
NanoHub U, online instruction.
Hi, and welcome back for the second lecture in the first week of this course in modern physics. What we're going to talk about in this lecture is we're going to do a review, actually, of classical concepts. And we're going to try and compare and contrast the behavior of particles and that of waves. And we're going to try and remind you of things that you probably already learned, but maybe have forgotten. So this is more of a review lecture to set the stage for a lot of the topics that are going to come in the next week or so. So let's begin with equations of motion of a particle. Okay, so we say a particle has a mass m, and we want to know how that particle moves on Earth under the influence of let's say, gravitation. Well, Newton was the first person that was able to solve this problem in a completely general way. This is in the 1680s, and the physics of particle motion places a very strong emphasis on predicting the future by being able to calculate the trajectory that a particle might follow. The way he does this is he says, with famous law of motion, the mass of the particle times the acceleration. The acceleration is the second derivative of the particle's position with respect to time, right? He says, that's equal to the sum of all the forces that are acting on the particle. And the forces that act on a particle are vector in nature, so you have to do a vector sum in order to calculate the right-hand side of this particular equation. So this is the famous F equals ma equation that you've learned in your previous study of physics. The acceleration of the particle is just given by the second derivative of the particle's position with respect to time. Now, solutions to this equation of motion are well worked out and they're established, right? The displacement of a particle as a function of time that satisfies Newton's law of motion is given by this first equation here. So if you're confined to motion in a let's say one direction, you have to know the initial velocity v0 and the acceleration a that's acting on the particle, and then as time progresses, you can predict the displacement of the particle. The particle has a property that resists motion. That's referred to as the inertial property of matter. And in linear particle motion, the inertia is just described by the mass m of the particle. Newton's second law says that F is equal to ma, and as a consequence of that, there's another quantity that's very interesting. It's referred to as the momentum. Momentum of a particle is just mass times the velocity of the particle, and you can rewrite. Right, you can rewrite Newton's law of motion in terms of changes in momentum with respect to time. So this is an equation that we're going to rely on heavily, actually, in the first couple weeks of the semester. There's a conservation of momentum principle. Right, that says that if there's no external force acting on an object which collides with something else, then the momentum the momentum before and the momentum after the collision is equal to a constant. So this is a conservation of energy or conservation of momentum principle that is used very often to calculate collisions between objects. And then lastly, we define something called the kinetic energy. Throughout the lectures, I'm just going to abbreviate the kinetic energy by capital K, and that kinetic energy for particle motion is just 1/2 mv squared. Now, all these equations for linear motion can be extended, and you can develop analogous equations for rotational motion. We're not going to go into that in this lecture. But you should be aware there's a one-to-one correspondence. For every equation in linear motion, there's an equivalent equation in rotational motion. And in this way, right, Newton's laws of motion have been applied to a straight line trajectory motion, motion in a plane, and then also rotational motion where there's a center of force. The particle revolves around that center. There's some very interesting derived quantities that follow from this discussion based on Newton's law of motion. The two we want to emphasize are work and potential energy. So what we say that if you apply a force to a mass and you move that mass through a distance dx, then you do work to move that particle, and the amount of work you do is equal to F times dx, right? F is a vector, dx is a vector, so you have to take the dot product. You only need the component of the force in the direction of motion in order to calculate the work. And if you go through a macroscopic trajectory from some initial point to some final point, then you have to integrate F dx over that trajectory in order to find the total work that you have done to move the particle from point A to point B. There's a derived concept referred to as potential energy. And potential energy is basically defined as minus the work that's been done on the object. So this is a very useful concept, and it basically is a way of describing how the particle interacts with its environment. And it gives rise to this definition of the potential energy. And we subscript the potential energy in this discussion by the capital letter P. P refers to a final point that a particle is placed. And so the idea or the concept of this potential energy is that if you take the negative integral of the force integrated into the distance dx that you travel, and you go from some reference location to some final location P, right? Then we say that the particle has acquired some potential energy. That potential energy can then be given back to you, right? If you, for instance, let the particle move back to its reference position. So the simplest example, of course, is the idea of rolling a ball up a hill, right? If you have the ball at the bottom of the hill, it has low potential energy. If you roll the ball up the hill, right, the potential energy of the ball increases. The potential energy that's stored in that ball when it's on top of the hill can be recovered if you let the ball roll back down the hill. Right, so this concept of potential energy is a way of telling how the object interacts with its environment, and it also tells you in a very general way something about how much energy is stored or as it can be associated with that particle at a particular point P, right? So that's something that we'll come back to many times as we set up these equations for quantum physics. We'll make use of this concept. Clearly, there's an equivalent definition for torque. I just write it down to be complete. There are a number of important consequences that come from the study of particle motion. And I like to just list these consequences very quickly here, right? There's this thing called the work energy theorem, which basically says that the net work that you do on a particle is related to the difference in the final minus the initial kinetic energies, Kf minus Ki. So if you do no work, then the kinetic energy K of a particle is a constant of the motion, right? If there are no external forces acting on a particle when two particles collide, then momentum is equal to a constant of motion, and this is often discussed in terms of Newton's third law. And also there's this very interesting theorem. It's called the virial theorem. Right, we'll make use of this in a few more lectures. The virial theorem says that if the potential energy varies as 1 over r, where r is the separation of the particle from some central point, right? Then the time average kinetic energy is just equal to minus 1/2 the time average potential energy. So this is an important theorem that's been proved and discussed, and we'll actually make use of it. And I just want to mention it here. Okay. There are important constants of the motion that have been linked in a very elegant way to underline symmetry principles. So usually the three conservation principles that you apply when you solve mechanic problems are conservation of energy, conservation of linear momentum, and conservation of angular momentum. And in 1915, Noether proved that these conservation principles underlie a symmetry in the equations of motion. So for instance, conservation of energy implies time translation symmetry, which means that basically the equations of motion are invariant under a transformation of time t to time t plus t zero, right? Conservation of linear momentum implies that the equations of motion are invariant under a transformation of position. So r, vector r, goes to a vector r plus capital R. Whenever the equations of motion are invariant under that transformation, then linear momentum is conserved. So a lot of these conservation principles that help you solve mechanical problems have their basis with a very elegant symmetry argument that that I try to outline in this slide. And it's important for you to realize that a lot of these things that you may take for granted in your study of mechanics have a very strong foundation, which is let's say a bit more subtle than you might be led to expect when you first study the subject. So just wanted to make that point. Now, the second half of this lecture focuses on waves, and I just want to say that waves are really different than particles, right? There's a number of things you can say that tries to illustrate this case, right? So first of all, what is a wave? Well, a wave is a traveling disturbance in some medium, and that medium could be water, it could be a solid bar, it could be gas, it could be a rope or a string, right? And if you perturb that material in some way, you can launch a wave, and that wave travels through the material. The disturbance that travels can be either transverse or longitudinal, which means that the displacement of the wave can be either perpendicular to the direction of motion or parallel to the direction of motion. Just depends on how the wave is excited. When you discuss waves, you're not so interested in trajectories anymore, which is in strong contrast to particle motion that we just reviewed very briefly. Waves do not actually transport material, right? There's no bulk transport of matter in a wave, but energy is transmitted, right? There is a transfer of energy from point A to point B by the wave, even though matter itself is not moved. One of the important properties of waves is that they can exhibit interference effects, so they can constructively and destructively interfere. And that is directly attributable to the fact that two waves can be at the same place at the same time. This cannot happen when you look at particle motion, right? Particle motion, you can't put two particles at the same point. So this constructive and destructive interference is something that's completely, at least in classical terms, it's completely focused on wave behavior. So what does a wave look like in general, and what do you try to predict when you try to predict a wave? Well, I just sketch here a disturbance, right? So this is, for instance, a string. The equilibrium position of the string is represented by this dashed line. if there's a wave traveling along the string, then the wave can cause the string to be displaced, as I've shown schematically by this sinusoidal trajectory. And it's important for you to focus on a point on the wave, right? That point on the wave is indicated by this dot here. This dot is displaced from its equilibrium position by a distance h, and that displacement h is clearly a function of position x, right? Because different points on this wave have different displacements. And also, this displacement can vary with time t, right? The peak value of the wave is indicated by this red dot. The peak value of the wave is referred to as the amplitude of the wave, and the amplitude of the wave can be read off from a chart here. Usually the amplitude is given by some symbol like A, right? The wavelength of the wave is the repeat distance between two points that are identical on the wave. So the wavelength lambda of the wave is represented by this distance here, and different waves launched in different ways will have different wavelengths lambda. So what is the equation of motion for a wave? In other words, how does this quantity h depend on position and time? So the standard wave equation is indicated in this yellow box here. It's a second order differential equation. The equation says that if you take the second derivative of the displacement h with respect to position x, you get a quantity that's equal to 1 over v squared times the second derivative of the displacement with respect to time. And this quantity 1 over v squared is known as the velocity of the wave. It's how fast the wave moves through this particular medium. Now, how's that equation derived, right? Well, it actually goes back to Newton's laws of motion. What you do is you focus on a small segment of the wave, right? That small segment of the wave has a length dx. There's a displacement dh along that small segment of the wave. The mass of that small segment is given by the mass density of the material through which the wave is propagating times the length, which is given by Pythagorean's theorem, right? So that tells you the mass of the wave. That tells you the mass of this infinitesimal element that's undergoing wave motion. You then calculate the forces that are acting on that mass, and you set that equal to mass times acceleration. And when you solve that equation, you end up with this equation of motion that I wrote down on the previous slide. Now, the interesting thing is that this equation of motion, which is derived in this case for a string that's been plucked and you launch a wave in the spring, right? This equation of motion applies generally to all wave motion in solid material, liquid material, gaseous material, right? The only difference between the different materials is the definition of the velocity. So for instance, if you've got a wave on a string, the velocity is equal to the square root of the tension in the string divided by the linear mass density rho. If you launch a wave in a solid bar of material, then the velocity of the wave is given by Young's modulus divided by the density of the material, the square root of that quantity. The same equation of motion applies to both situations. So that's kind of a unique property of waves. You just have to change the velocity to match the conditions, to match the medium through which the wave is propagating. But the nature of the wave equation basically stays the same. Now, what formulas, what functions for H solve that differential equation? So that's what the next slide tries to address, right? And I write down a potential solution, which is for H is a function of X and T, which is based on sinusoidal waves, right? So I say that the h of x and t could be represented by an equation that has the following form, right? X is the position of the wave, lambda is the wavelength of the wave, t is any particular time t that you choose to look at the displacement, and then capital T is the period. It's the time it takes for the wave to oscillate through one complete cycle. This solution for x is often rewritten in terms of this kx minus omega t notation, where k is referred to as the wave vector of the wave, and that's defined as 2 pi divided by the wavelength, and omega is referred to as the angular frequency of the wave, that's equal to 2 pi divided by the period t of the wave. Now, how do you know that proposed solution is in fact a solution of that wave equation? Well, what you have to do is you have to plug it in and work through the arithmetic and see what happens, right? And if you do that, the arithmetic is pretty straightforward. What you find at the end of the day is that the solution is valid provided V squared is equal to omega squared over K squared, right? So this tells you that there's a relationship between the angular frequency of the wave and the wave vector of the wave and the velocity V that that wave propagates. And this relationship is referred to as the dispersion relation for the wave. And for this particular case, for waves on a string, omega versus K gives you a linear curve, and the slope of that curve is equal to the velocity V of the wave, okay? So this important result can be rewritten in terms of parameters that may be more familiar to you in terms of the wavelength lambda and the frequency in hertz, right? And you end up with this very important equation that describes all waves, which says the velocity, the magnitude of the velocity of the wave is just equal to the wavelength lambda times the frequency f of the wave, okay? So that comes directly out of that proposed solution and following through the differential equation that describes wave motion. Are there any other solutions to the wave equation? And I have to say, yes, there are. There's a very famous solution which describes confined waves. So these are waves which are confined, let's say, between two blocks of solid material. So here's a string that's been stretched. The string has been plucked, right? And if the length of the string is L, then what's the displacement of the string as a function of position and time for these confined waves? So the solution for the confined wave problem is given as a product of two functions. One function is a function only of position, x. The other is a function only of time, t, right? And the solutions are often written in terms of a sine and a cosine, as I've got drawn here, okay? These parameters phi and delta are adjustable parameters that allow you to match the boundary conditions. And so, for instance, the boundary conditions in this particular problem would say that the string has to have zero displacement at x equal to zero here and at x equal to L, right? And when you apply those boundary conditions, that allows you to uniquely specify the two phases, phi and delta, and it gives rise to this quantized condition that says not all k's are allowed, right? There are only quantized values of k, and those quantized values of k have to satisfy this equation, which says kl is equal to n times pi, where n is some integer. And this just simply means that the number of wavelengths that fit between these two blocks, okay, these two solid walls, the number of wavelengths has to be quantized in order to match the boundary conditions. Okay, so you can take that proposed solution, you can substitute it into the wave equation, you can convince yourself that that proposed solution does in fact satisfy the wave equation, and you can convince yourself that you get a dispersion relationship which is identical to the one we derived on the previous slide. V squared is equal to omega squared over k squared. Right, so I also want to make the point that these standing waves are really the sum of two waves that are propagating in opposite directions. So this is a topic that's going to come back repeatedly in the first couple weeks of the course. And here I work this out, right, where I show that you can take two waves, one moving to the right, one moving to the left. You can add them together, and you end up getting this standing wave, right? So the standing wave is really the sum of two waves, one moving in the minus x direction, another moving in the plus x direction. If you want a visual graph of how that works, I try to provide some pictures here to illustrate this important point, right? What I've got here is I've got two waves. I got a red wave and a blue wave. The red wave is moving to the right. The blue wave is moving to the left. And then I just focus at one point, which is this point indicated by this solid dot. And I add the red and the blue waves together, and I get the displacement of this solid dot for different times t, right? And so what you find is that these standing waves just vibrate about some equilibrium position, right? They go up and down, right? And the details of how far up or how far down they go is a function of time, can be very nicely analyzed graphically by considering the sum of these two waves, one wave moving to the right and one wave moving to the left. Okay, so I think that ends the topics that I wanted to discuss in this lecture. What we're going to do in the next lecture is we're going to extend this discussion to Maxwell's electromagnetic waves. Everything I've talked about here is about wave propagation in either a solid, a liquid, a gas, or along a string, right? All these ideas apply to those situations. In 1864, Maxwell made this amazing prediction about electromagnetic waves. And he took over a lot of this information that I've already discussed and applied it to disturbances of electric and magnetic fields. So the next lecture will review the important results that come from that apply to Maxwell's electromagnetic waves. So we'll see you for that lecture soon.